Hey guys, welcome to the Linux channel. So once you start learning about networking protocols, especially the network protocol RFCs, you may notice that there are certain protocols which will have a fixed header length, and also there are going to happen, whichever it is going to have a fixed header length, most cases it is also going to have its fields which is also going to be fixed size. But once you go towards application layer based protocols, you can find they are sort of dynamic in length because it has to carry a sort of dynamic fields within the entire chunk of protocol as such. So what it is going to have, it is going to have more like a TLV kind of structure. So TLV stands for type, length and value. So it is going to have a sort of TLV sort of structure. So if you take an example like HTTPS, a simple application layer protocol, it is going to have a dynamic headers, as one can understand in HTTP protocol. So let me open some couple of samples of Wireshark packet captures and we can discuss in detail. So it is quite easy. If you see anything which is in lower layers, like layer 2 or layer 3 or layer 4, so what is going to happen is these kind of protocols will have sort of fixed size. We can just ignore about the IP options and the TCP options because that is going to make the IP header as a dynamic sized header. So same thing happens with the TCP. So whereas in a case like UDP, if you consider UDP's header length is fixed, so this is what happens most of the cases in lower layers. It can be slow protocols, it can be any kind of routing protocols and stuff like that. Whereas if you see any application layer protocol, say for example we can consider DNS as well. So if you take an example of DNS, HTTP or even something like RADIUS, even SSL, all these application layer protocols are going to have more or less like a TLV structure. So we can do one thing is we can open a sample HTTP capture. So I have this, as you can see here, I have this sample captures of Wireshark, and apart from that, I have my own collection of sample packets because I have a small database of these sample captures so that I can have a reference of the same. So you can also have a sort of personal copy of the same in case if you want to refer them again and again, and you have an interesting packets which you have managed to capture in your lab or else in your real-time networks. So as an example, what we can do is in this case we can pick an HTTP packet. So it is going to take multiple samples. In this case, what we can do is we can take one example. So we can open this cap file. So it is automatically going to ask to open in Wireshark automatically, as you can see here. So we can open any HTTP header and we can see here it is going to have, as you can see here, by the way, this is the HTTP packet, a sample packet I have opened, and hope you can notice here its structure is more or less like a TLV structure. In this case, they don't have this length field. Please understand, always TLV doesn't mean it is going to look the same. So it is going to have a type, length and a value record. So what is happening here is each record, it is going to have like three fields. A typical TLV, it is going to have type or a sort of identifier, and then it is going to have its value. So you can take like a database, you can have employee ID, and then its value is going to have some number, and then you can have employee name, and then it's going to have any employee name, and then the length, it is going to define the total length of this specific row. So this helps the parsers or protocol parsers to parse these fields, and they can populate in a data structure. So you can have a struct, you can have some kind of dynamic data structure in that you can parse these records or else these rows, and then you can populate in a data structure. So that's the overall concept is about. So that is why mostly in application layer protocols definition, it is going to have this kind of arrangement so that you can put them in any order, because the parser can end of the day parse these records and it can populate it in its parser's data structure. So this is what exactly happens with HTTP as well. So you can see here it is going to have this type, because this is more of text-based protocol, so this is one of the easiest protocols to understand as well. So you can see it is showing a host and user agent and accept and accept language and things like that. So all these corresponds to type of the TLV, and it is directly getting assigned with a value. So you can see here it is having the value as host is ethereal.com, and it is going to have accept language en-us and things like that. So it's directly assigned with corresponding value. So you have the type and the value. In this case, it doesn't need any length because it is anyway understandable. It is getting delimited with this carriage return and backslash n. So backslash r, backslash n. So that is going to be its delimiter. So we know that when the parser is parsing, it is going to parse for backslash r, backslash n. If this specific character is coming within the value or somewhere, it can use any kind of delimiter. So that's not an issue in a case of a parser design. So exactly what is happening is the parser is going to look for backslash r, backslash n. So each time when it comes, it is going to terminate a single record, and then it is going to parse that specific record, and it is also having this delimiter colon and space. Or so with that, what is happening is it is exactly terminating the type field and then its corresponding value. So both are delimited with this colon and space, and followed by which you have this backslash r, backslash n. So this is what exactly happening in a case like HTTP protocol. So in case we decode a typical IP header, what is happening is, let's expand this IP header. So you can see here it is having mostly all our fixed fields, and then even the IP header in most cases is going to be 20 bytes, as you can see here. So when you highlight this IP header, it is highlighting this entire raw binary portion of the same. You can see here it is going to have this 20 bytes, and it is going to have all the necessary fields of a typical IP header. So if you open any IP header specification, you can see here. Yeah, you can see in Google Images, you can open any of this kind of an image. Once you open it, you can see it is very much relevant and very much explicit that this is a sort of best example of a fixed header or else a fixed sized protocol header. In this case, even it is going to have fixed sized fields. So you can have each designated field has a specific length which is assigned. So in case certain fields, it is going to have also kind of a single byte is also going to take multiple fields within a single byte. So it is not necessary each byte corresponds to something, or else each set of bytes correspond to something. Whereas in a case like source address and destination address, four bytes constitutes an IP header address. Whereas in a case like the first octet or the first byte, you can see here it is going to comprise both the version and as well as the IP header length indicator. Because I need to say it's an indicator because it is not exactly going to tell what's the total length. It is just an indicator. It is going to have it. So let us open the Wireshark capture. You can see here it says 45 in hexadecimal over here below. So its header length is indicating that totally there are 5 octets. So in this way it is represented. So when you design any parser of low level protocol stack parsers, so what happens is you need this kind of arrangement. That is the reason in the kernel space or in the user space, if you use a struct IP header, you can just do a sort of typecast. So let me open a kernel source, and then we can say net IPv4. So as a quick sample, I'm opening the same. You can do a similar thing with any kind of reference or user space code as well. So you can see here IP input, IP header. So you can see here in this case a struct IP header, and you open this struct, it is going to have this kind of an arrangement, and with just a simple typecast, you can directly parse a set of bytes directly into this IP header. So it has all this notation, so that it has to take care of you know, big endian, little endian, stuff like that, and then it can be directly parsable. So if you go back, you can see certain examples of the same. And yeah, you can see here it is directly getting the IP header of SKB, and then it is assigning it to that pointer. So in these cases, these kind of fixed sized protocols doesn't have to do much amount of parsing. It just have to, it's just a sort of, you know, translation between a bunch of bytes into, you know, parsed protocol data structure. So it is quite easy. Whereas in a case like a HTTP case, you can understand that it needs some amount of manual parsing. Let me open the Wireshark capture again. So in this case of HTTP, you can well understand that it is not quite straightforward. You need to kind of use a typical parser technique, and I mean like a lexical parser or something like that. So you need to you know, read ahead the bytes, and you need to see where this termination occurs, and then collect all these bytes and then put it in a place, and then in that again you need to split with this delimiter, and then take the you know, type part and take the value part, and the length is not required because in this case it is terminated with this backslash r backslash n character. So this is what exactly happens. So we can take also some couple of examples, and exactly there are also cases like SSL if you take an example. So let me close this, and what we can do is we can take another example like SSL or HTTPS. Yeah, you can take an example like this. So in this case, you can see here, you can see a packet, a good example like client hello, server hello, and stuff like that. Don't open SSL packets which have completely you know, encrypted you know, file or encrypted content in it. Instead, to understand SSL, you can open this kind of initial credentials which are getting exchanged. So in this you can get clues of the architecture of the protocol. So if you take an example like this SSL traffic, so you can see here it is having this exact TLB structure. So it is having this type, so which denotes it is a handshake. In this case hexadecimal is 16 and you know decimal is 22, the value is 22, and its version. And then it is going to have this length field as is, and then it is going to have this data field. So it is exactly having this TLB structure. So type, length, and then its corresponding value. So in this case, the parser, all it has to do is it has to see its type, and it has to see the length field, and based on the length field, it will understand what exactly it is going to hold, how many bytes next it is going to hold. So this way you can have a structure that you can have consecutive fields or records of this kind of TLB arrangement, and in case if it has multiple TLBs, you can parse all these records, and then you can populate it in its you know, corresponding dynamic data structure of, you know, these kind of TLB protocols. So that is the reason, you know, a TLB TLB is a sort of a standard used for more cases like application layer protocols, where in which you can't use a fixed sized header or else a fixed sized fields in that case. So in within the TLBs, you can have, of course, you know, fixed sized fields. So you may have most cases you may need 2 bytes for a length and 1 byte for, you know, type and things like that. So one can understand, you can see a comparison between HTTP versus HTTPS in a case like TLB or else protocol architecture. You can see how compact is this design is versus that, you know, architecture of HTTP. It is more text intensive, even its type is mentioned in the form of a text. But there is an advantage by doing so, because if you do a text based, you know, TLB, you can add your custom records. You don't need to define extensively the protocol standards and stuff like that. So you can have custom records. You can also mention any custom tags. You can mention like ABC colon and it may have a custom value. It may be your own custom defined, you know, extra headers for your HTTP, where in which the common parsers may ignore these headers, whereas you may have a special browser or, you know, some kind of HTTP, you know, app or something like that, an app based on HTTP, you know, packets, say for example UPnP or DLNA. So in that case, you can pass these special tags or special fields, and then you can get its corresponding values and you can take the decision what to be done. So this is the case for any kind of application layer protocol in most cases. So next, what we can do is we can also take another interesting protocol sample, like Radius protocol. Radius is meant to authenticate and stuff like that. It will be used in Wi-Fi routers and things like that. So you can take a sample of Radius protocol. It is again based on TLV based architecture. So we can take a sample packet of Radius. Yeah, so you can see here, this is a typical sample capture of Radius protocol. So you can see here, even in this case, it has this TLV based architecture. You have this code and then packet identifier and length and so on as such. So what I mean, TLV is not exactly like it is going to have the similar structure everywhere. It depends on protocol to protocol. It depends on specific architecture or RFC standards of the protocol specific case as such. So in the case of Radius, it looks like that, whereas if you take a simple example like DNS, you can see each time the domain has a single word, like, you know, www.google.com, the three W's is going to have a sort of TLV arrangement, and it is also going to have the entire domain query in the sort of TLV arrangement. So let's take an example of a DNS in this case. So let me do a fresh Wireshark capture and sudo. So if you are a network, going to be a network software developer, this is going to be your first step in order to, you know, put all the pieces together and try to understand the puzzle, exactly what it is all about. So this gives a good, you know, start for you to get into this domain. So let me take a sample. I'm opening Facebook. Yeah, so I captured the packets of Facebook access. So in that, you can see here, there is a DNS query and it is going to the IP 8.8.8, which is the Google's DNS server. So you can see here, it has this sort of arrangement. Say we take an example of www.facebook.com. So in this case, you can see here, for the three W's, it has this notation of 3, and then you know, www, which is 77 in hexadecimal the www, and then you have this Facebook string. The length of Facebook is totally 8 characters, so you can see here it is showing as 8, and then followed by it has this com. So you have this com, and then it has this delimiter or the length, which denotes as 3. So each time there is a word, it denotes the total length of this word. Again, this is a sort of, you know, TLV based arrangement, so that when you parse these kind of strings, the parser APIs will know how to parse this kind of dynamic strings, because it is necessarily going to be a dynamic, you know, length based protocols, or it is going to be a dynamic length, because you know, it is not anything we are restricting, that so and so domains can be used or something like that. Tomorrow you can have even a very long domain name as well. So in that case, the parser have to be flexible, it has to be dynamic, and it should have that sort of architecture in place. So that is why it is in application layer you know, protocols, it has this kind of unique approach. So you can see here, once it is, once the domain name ends, it also has this delimiter with 0 bytes and stuff like that. So this is what most of the cases happens. Whereas in case, if you see the UDP header, you can see always a UDP header's length is, fixed, and it's each header's field is also fixed. So you can see a Google image of UDP header. So as you can see here, the UDP header is going to be fixed size. You can see the source port, destination port, and then checksum and its length. Each is going to be like 2 bytes, and you can see each of these fields are going to be fixed length. And whereas in a case like TCP, as you can see here, other than options, it has all this fixed length fields. So this way, what happens is when they design these kind of parsers, as I said earlier, there is no much work is involved. You just need to have a struct which corresponds to these byte locations of your packet buffer. So you just need to do is a typecast and then make sure it is a big endian and little endian check is ensured, and then it is appropriately done so that it automatically gets parsed, and you can directly have the struct member variables which correspond to these kind of internal fields. So this is what is the most convenient way when you treat or process the lower level protocol header. Because this architecture is required, sometimes these packets may get processed in network hardware, or else there may be some kind of offloaded hardware, or you may have also like cases like a GRO, GSO and stuff like that in a NIC card. So when you do any kind of hardware level processing of packets, you need something like this. Whereas in application layer protocols, most of the cases the application layer protocols will get processed in user space. So user space will have enough conveniences so that you may even can parse these records with a C++ parser, or else if in a case like Firefox, you may have something like assume Firefox is implemented in C++, so you can parse these records in C++. And you may also have any JavaScript, so you can also have any Java based applications, or also PHP based applications, or also Python and so on. So in all these cases it is quite easy, because you may have a very good regular expression APIs, and then you may have other parsing APIs with which you can easily parse these records, and then you can populate it in your data structures. So this is what exactly you should understand once you start understanding your network software protocol development. This is your first step. You need to understand various kinds of protocols, and you need to also understand why it is architected as such. And if you want to be a software developer, you need to understand these aspects, because based on this you design your parsers, based on this you design your packet builders and your entire network stack. So this is quite vital to understand, and also its implications, why it is done so and so. If it is something you are attempting to assume, you are writing your own RFC, you can think about in which layer it is going to work. It is in kernel space, or it is going to reside in user space. So based on that, you need to architect your RFC. So hope you guys liked watching this video, guys. In case if you have any questions, you can discuss in YouTube comments. Thank you once again for watching this video, guys. Have a nice day. Bye bye.